The next case is Nelson and Rapp versus Weber. I see two attorneys in front of me. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, I'll call the case Nelson and Rapp versus Weber. We've set it for 15 minutes per side. And I think, Mr. Callis, you go first.
Thank you, Your Honor. If it please the court, this is a case that revolves around a civil rights complaint. It has two distinct parts. One part deals with whether or not a memorandum of understanding between Washington Department of Correction and the United States Marshal Service constitutes a contract that changes the status of the DOC agents and keeps them as DOC agents, or whether their appointment as deputy marshals to work on a task force controls their activities. The second part deals with the use of force against the appellants. And there are two different issues there. One is the fact that Officer Weber drove his car directly into and head on with the appellant's car. At the time, the appellant was in a position to drive past Officer Weber without any contact, and there was no one else in the area that could have been threatened, and the appellant's car was going approximately 20, 25 miles an hour, which is not a high speed or dangerous chase. Thus, the use of deadly force to stop the car is improper.
Well, the deadly force didn't stop the car. The deadly force shot Mr. Nelson after the car was stopped.
Well, that's a second issue, Your Honor. The use of the automobile as a weapon has been held by courts all over the country, including North Ninth Circuit, as deadly force.
Well, but so, deadly force to stop a car during going 25 miles an hour doesn't sound like deadly force.
The officer is going 15 or so miles an hour. Both cars are totally destroyed. The airbags are deployed. That's a serious accident. Neither car could be moved. And the courts have said that a police officer attempting to terminate a chase through the use of deadly force are able to do so by using their vehicles or guns if someone is in imminent danger, including people in the area. But in this case, there was no imminent danger, and there was no reason for Officer Weber to turn his car into and strike Ms. Rapp's car.
Mr. Callis, can I ask you a more higher level question before you start
Sure. Diving
into the facts, which is we have one set of issues here is, were they acting under the color of state law or federal law? And another set of issues is, are the officers entitled to qualified immunity?
Correct.
On the second issue, the district court said they were entitled to qualified immunity. Either it was no constitutional violation, or at least it wasn't clearly established. If the district court is right on that, does it matter whether this claim really sounds in Section 1983 or Bivens? In other words, if we were to agree hypothetically with the district court on the qualified immunity, do we need to answer this other question about under the color of which law were the officers operating?
I would think there would be an interest in dealing with the effects of a memorandum of understanding and clarifying whether or not 3374 applies, given the broad shift of responsibility from the Marshal Service to the DOC. I think that stands as an interest, public interest type of issue. The issue of the qualified immunity, I would agree that if qualified immunity is granted, the granting of, or the, even the looking at the contract issues would probably be unnecessary because they would not apply at that point. But that doesn't mean they're not important to resolve.
Okay. Is it on the first question then, on under color of state law or under color of federal law, is it your view that the officers could only be acting under one or the other at any given time, or is it possible they could have been operating under both?
As we stated in our brief, Your Honor, they could be operating under both. It's a dual agency issue. Then the question becomes, under dual agency, which of the two authorities has the most control, is primarily responsible? And that's clear from the MOU that the DOC has that, by a large percentage, has that responsibility.
Could I just interrupt for a moment?
Sure.
Is it your position that the a plaintiff in this situation could have brought a claim under either Bivens or 1983 or both, if there's a dual agency, or is it one or the other?
I don't think it matters. If it's DOC that's the agent, then he can bring it under 1983. If DOC is a dual agent with primary responsibility, then he can bring it under 1983. If the Marshal Service has primary management and responsibility in a dual agency situation, then it would have to be brought under Bivens.
So you're saying it's either one or the other. And in your view, a court would have to determine which was primary. Am I understanding that right?
Basically, yes, Your Honor. The MOU spells out, I believe it's 7 specific areas in which the DOC maintains or retains primarily responsibility for the agents that it sends to the task force. In that same memorandum, the Marshal Service retains responsibility for scheduling and deployment. So everything from use of force, material, rules and regulations are all controlled by the DOC, with the exception of the scheduling and deployment of the officers within the task force. Does that explain that?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so get back to your question, Judge Bress. I think that the way it's set up with the task force overview, that when an officer goes from a city or state or county agency to a task force, there is a question of who manages them. Now, this issue has not been really raised in any court. I can't find anything in the Ninth Circuit in which the contract or memorandum of understanding is analyzed to determine who has primary responsibility. There is a case on the East Coast that we cited, Guzman, which was a dual agency case. And in that case, the court found that the city was the primary agent and said it wasn't a situation for a Bivens case, it was a 1983 case. But other than that, the issue raised here is really, I think, a first impression in the Ninth Circuit. And it's something that should be addressed, because these agreements between these agencies and local law enforcement are becoming more and more common.
What is the significance of this? I mean, there's clearly an attorney's fees, a fee shifting significance between the two sources of law. Are there any other differences?
Not really. A Bivens case is a 1983 case by another name. It doesn't allow the 1988 remedies. But from the point of view of my clients, the appellants, it makes a big difference. This is a case in which the economic damages to the appellants are relatively minuscule. And almost no attorney would take this case because the remuneration based on a contingency would be nil.
Well, how can that be so? Mr. Nelson was shot in the head, and you're saying he's not getting any money for that? No, I'm assuming liability.
Yeah, he would get some money for it, but he didn't lose any earning capacity.
Listen, if I'm shot in the head, I'm expecting I'm going to get a fair amount of money for that.
And we would ask for that.
Right. So I'm not sure this is a minuscule liability case if you can show liability.
Okay. Depending upon the jury, Your Honor, I agree it could be a substantial amount of money.
Yeah.
But to get back to one of the questions you asked earlier, there really are two different use of force issues here. And the use of force against Ms. Rapp in crashing into her car is one issue. That also affected Nelson. The second issue just involves Nelson, and that is the shooting of 18 rounds in 2 seconds when he supposedly had made a furtive gesture. But we go back to basically Judge Kaczynski's ruling in Cruz and subsequent rulings in Summers, Santa Clara, which was a 2001, a 2021 case, which brought back Kaczynski's analysis, that if there's any reason to believe that the officer's statement that the person made a furtive gesture is not true, then you can't grant summary judgment on it. And in this case, we have the officer misrepresenting at least two times. He said that in his reports and in his deposition to start with, he said Ms. Rapp turned into him. And there's two witnesses who say that's not true, and there's an independent forensic examiner, accident expert, who said it's absolutely clear that Weber turned into Rapp and Rapp was going to go past him. And then there's all the photos of the accident that show where the impacts were that even a novice would see could only be caused by Weber turning into Rapp.
Hey, so can you Weber, focus on the second, on the shooting?
Sure.
Because it seems there you've raised two claim disputes of fact. One, whether the officer had a sight line, and two, what was there a movement, a furtive movement towards what could have been a firearm? So what do you contend are the disputes of fact, material disputes of fact on both of those points?
Sure. The sight line, clearly from where the bullets impact and from his testimony that he aimed over his gun, the sight line that he had was over the crumpled hood of the car, and that was the top 4 inches of the windshield. He couldn't see anything below that. That would be basically from Mr. Nelson's nose up. So first of all, we think it's the evidence on that is physical evidence that anybody can see. And it's clear that Mr. Weber could not see Mr. Nelson's shoulders or chest. But even if he could see Mr. Weber's shoulders, the state wants to take the position that a shoulder movement, or perhaps even the cocking of a head to look down, is sufficient to justify the use of deadly force. And that's not what a furtive movement has been defined as in the past. It's been defined as a motion towards the waist to retrieve a weapon. It looks like it's a retrieve weapon. Here, there was no weapon. And again, going back to Cruz, we have to wonder at the self-serving nature of this testimony, given that physical evidence shows he couldn't see what he said he saw. That puts him in dispute again. So there are factual matters of dispute concerning whether Weber turned in turned into Ms. Rapp's car, or whether Ms. Rapp turned into Officer Weber's car. There's a factual dispute as to whether Officer Weber could even see the chest of Mr. Nelson. Now, all the bullets that hit are consistent with the top view of the windshield. Mr. Nelson testified he had his hand up. Mr. Nelson testified that he was shot in the hand and the head while his hand was up. There's also testimony that says that Mr. Nelson's deposition that says that he was hit with the impact, it rocked us back. So I racked back a little bit in the seat with the car. And when I come forward, when the vehicle settles, that's when they started firing. So even assuming that Officer Weber could see Mr. Nelson, the fact that Mr. Nelson was moving, given the totality of the circumstances, does not lead to the conclusion that he was reaching for a gun. He'd just been in an accident that destroyed two SUVs, deployed airbags, caused Officer Weber a concussion and a cut over his right eye, his left eye, which bled into his eye. There's a lot of questions of fact that are in dispute. Okay. And the court should not have granted summary judgment.
Let's hear from the other side, and we'll give you a chance to respond.
Thank you.
May it please the court, Kaylin Watt on behalf of the only remaining defendant, Officer Nicholas Weber. Qualified immunity was properly granted here because Officer Weber acted reasonably both in blocking the escape vehicle of two wanted felons with his car and for shooting at fugitive Nelson after observing Nelson apparently reaching for a gun. And so I'll just jump in where counsel left off. There's no dispute of fact about what Officer Weber could see. Counsel makes arguments from photographs, not from facts. Officer Weber testified that he could see Nelson from the diaphragm up. He also testified that in his car, yes, his hood was crumpled, but he moved over, he raised himself up. He physically was able to overcome those barriers to see Nelson. And if he couldn't see Nelson and Rapp, then why was it so important to Rapp to raise Nelson's hands up and shout, stop shooting? I would also point out that Cruz here doesn't apply because the plaintiffs are both alive and well, and their testimony was entirely consistent with what Officer Weber's testimony was and what Officer Weber could see. And that is, Nelson testified that his hands were down when the shooting started. He put them up and then he put them down again. He also testified that his head was turned entirely to the right. But on the next page of his testimony, he says his neck was broken in a motorcycle accident, which he was in another instance fleeing from a trooper who was trying to stop him for speeding, and he can no longer turn his neck without turning his entire body. So when Nelson testifies that his head is turned entirely to the right when he's shot, that is consistent with what Officer Weber saw. That is that Nelson's left shoulder was forward and his right shoulder was back. That plus all of the facts that Officer Weber has in confronting the situation shows that his use of force was reasonable. And
let me ask you this, assuming that we believe all of the testimony from the officer, I'm not yet convinced that the use of deadly force, 16 rounds, for someone who's in the other car in the immediate aftermath of an accident was justified. I mean, he's not out of the car. We don't know that he had a gun. We do know that he's a suspect for having stolen weapons, but we don't, I mean, there's no other evidence that he's armed at that time. That sounds to me as though it's a pretty quick and I might say ill-considered response on the spur of the moment. Maybe he gets off on qualified immunity, but this one strikes me as a pretty close case as to whether it's justified.
Well, Your Honor, we have to remember everything that Officer Weber knows about Nelson and the fact that he has to make a split-second judgment. And so, yes, Nelson is wanted for burglarizing a gun store. The guns have not all been recovered.
But we don't know that he's burglarized. We know that he's a suspect.
We know he's a suspect. We also know the day before this operation takes place, the Kitsap County Sheriff's Office has received a tip that Nelson was seen armed with a handgun. We also know that Nelson has made statements conveyed to the task force that he has no intention of surrendering and he has no intention of making it easy on the arresting officers. And then we have the situation itself where when Officer Weber and Officer Poston enter this cul-de-sac to effectuate this arrest, Ms. Rapp admittedly loses control of her vehicle, drives toward their vehicles. There's this collision. Officer Weber is confronted with this threat directly in front of him. This is not a head-on collision. The plaintiff's experts testified it was about a 50% overlap where Officer Weber is seeing Nelson head on because he's hit the left side of that vehicle. Officer Weber is injured. His partner is in no situation to address any threat, and Officer Weber has to make that split second judgment. And when he sees Nelson turned all the way to the right, he believes he's armed, he has to act accordingly. This court held in George v. Morris that a furtive gesture, a harrowing gesture, when the suspect is presumed armed, is a reasonable use of force. Officers are not required to wait to see the gun before they act to deal with a threat. And that, in this situation, is a reasonable use of force. The government's interest under the Graham factors is heavy here. Nelson poses an immediate threat to the safety of officers. His crimes are serious. He's robbed a gun store. And third, he's actively resisting arrest. He's been evading arrest for 2 weeks. And here again, as Rapp testifies, she's trying to get around the cop cars. He's still trying to evade arrest. The government's interest in the use of force here is very strong. The purpose of this mission is to take Nelson and Rapp into custody, and that's what they're doing. And then when Nelson appears to reach for a gun, Officer Weber must act on that.
In this excessive force context, does the excessive force determination overlap completely with the clearly established issue, or are they distinct?
Well, the qualified immunity analysis is, of course, a two-pronged test, and your honors can take either prong in whichever manner you please. Here, the excessive force was reasonable, but moreover, there's no clearly established precedent that would tell Officer Weber that his use of force under these facts in the situation he confronts was unlawful. It was plaintiff's obligation to come forward with that precedent, and they've not done so. Under these facts, again, if shooting was reasonable in Mullinex, if shooting was reasonable in Brousseau, shooting was reasonable in this court's case, Wilkinson v. Torres, then shooting is reasonable here based on what Officer Weber saw. So the precedent actually supports his actions rather than telling them they're beyond constitutional debate as being wrong. Likewise, the use of the car to stop these suspects from fleeing is, it's constitutional and it's a reasonable use of force. Vehicle-to-vehicle seizures are constitutionally permissible, and officers are entitled to use reasonable force to effectuate an arrest, which is all this was. This was not a high-speed collision. The plaintiff's
Getting back to the question about Bivens versus 1983, do you agree that we don't have to resolve that question if we determine that Mr. Weber was entitled to qualified immunity?
Absolutely. The analysis for qualified immunity is the same under either Section 1983 or Bivens.
And if we do reach it, do you agree with opposing counsel that a person has to be operating under either color of state law or under color of federal law and can't be acting under both at the same time? And if so, what's the authority for that?
I am aware of no authority that provides that an officer might be acting under both. I am aware of authority that finds that they need to be acting one or the other. I believe counsel cited to Gibson in their briefs for this idea that it could be both, but if you follow the Gibson trail of cases, it relies on a case that was decided in 1969 before Bivens was decided in 1971. And we know from Bivens that federal officers are not subject to 1983 liability, and there is ample evidence that the officers were acting under federal authority here. First and foremost, they are deputized as United States Marshals. There's another great example in the record. There was a pre-operational task force meeting at the Tacoma United States Marshal Service office before this group went to Bremerton to effectuate this arrest. There's also the post-operational report in the record. Operation Twilight was a success because it took Officer Nelson into arrest. If you look at the memorandum of understanding relied so heavily on plaintiffs, it says right on it that nothing herein waives or limits sovereign immunity under federal or state statutory or constitutional law. And moreover, of course, plaintiffs have provided no authority that parties must cite to or include the law in their contracts in order to make the law apply, nor do they provide any authority that parties can so easily contract around the law by failing to include it in a contract. And there's really...
I've got a question to you that, the question is really representation. I see you from the AG's office, the state AG's office. If we were to conclude that this is a Bivens case, and if we were to conclude, and I'm, this is an if, this is not a we will, if we were to conclude that there's a potential for liability here, shouldn't we be hearing from somebody other than the state AG's office? Because you're trying to say that it's not, he's working for the feds rather than for you. So why are you representing him?
Under the memorandum of understanding and the statutes that apply, the Department of Corrections continues to have responsibility for these officers, continues to pay them. The federal government does not pay them. They're paid by the state. And they, you know, follow the department's use of force policies. But they're deemed to be federal agents acting under federal law. First, they're deemed to be federal agents under the memorandum.
That's my question. So if they're deemed to be federal agents operating under federal law, why is the state AG representing them?
Because under the memorandum of understanding, the Department of Corrections retains responsibility for them. But that doesn't change that they're acting under federal authority. The Department of Corrections is not in the business of pursuing county warrants such as this one. It's a state agency. It doesn't have the authority to go arresting people on county warrants. The Department of Corrections can arrest on its own authority under its own secretary's warrants, or if it sees somebody under their jurisdiction, an offender basically on probation, commit a crime directly in front of them, then they can arrest. But DOC officers are not your regular peace officers that simply go out and make arrests. They would need some greater authority to pursue a Kitsap County warrant.
Do you know if the United States agrees with your position that the officers were acting under color of federal law?
Yes, Your Honor. A United States attorney did appear for at least one of the depositions to assert the law enforcement privilege to protect the entire operation and the investigation aspects part of it. However, they have not come in to defend this case, and the United States is, of course, not a party because it's not subject to Bivens liability.
But you say the United States is not subject to Bivens liability. You're saying that because the judgment runs against the officer in the individual capacity.
Right. So under Bivens, of course, there's no injunctive relief available. It's only the individual officer's actions. And under the memorandum of understanding, if there was to be liability found here, the Department of Corrections would be on the hook for that. Just based on state statute, I believe in, you know, across the states, it's up to the agency whether it will pay out on a Bivens case or not.
So the state is indemnifying the officer for liability he incurs acting under color of federal law?
If liability were to be found, the state of Washington does do that, yes.
That's by contract between you and the officer?
It's by statute.
By statute, okay.
And likewise, if the officers are acting in good faith in their official capacities, they're entitled to a defense from the Attorney General's office, again, by statute. And here, that's what they were doing. The officers were part of a federal task force whose mission was to take Nelson and Rapp into custody. They were acting under the order of Officer Whitehouse, who was the lead officer in this operation, who told them to go into this cul-de-sac, block this vehicle's escape, and take these two suspects into custody. And that's what they did. They dealt with the facts they were confronted with when Ms. Rapp lost control of her vehicle and there was a collision. And then when Officer Weber believed he saw Nelson reach for a weapon and acted accordingly, all of this was reasonable force that was used to take these suspects into custody. And in this case, the district court got it right. There's no constitutional violation at issue here. There's no clearly established precedent that would tell these officers that they were acting unlawfully, and thus qualified immunity was properly granted and should be affirmed in this case.
Any further questions from the bench? Okay, let's put 2 minutes on the clock for response.
Several things. Number one, the U.S. attorney refused to allow any discussion of other warrants or other documents created during this event. So we don't know what happened with Ms. Rapp. We do know there's nothing in the record that suggests that Ms. Rapp was wanted for anything at the time of this incident. And magistrate judge Creator actually said there's nothing in the record. He agreed. So for them to bring up that Rapp was wanted for a crime is completely unsupported. Secondly, it's interesting to see that the state is relying on the MOU now, and at the same time says that the appellants can't. The MOU assigns compensation and retirement and wages to DOC. It has rules governing the use of force by DOC employees, and they're to be followed. The memorandum of understanding says that the majority of the equipment used by the DOC, vest, weapons, etc., will be provided by the DOC. Evaluation and disciplinary procedures shall be DOC for DOC employees. The DOC is responsible for the conduct of its employees that are assigned to the task force. Original reports, evidence, etc., shall be retained by the agency bringing it in. And in the event of a shooting involved task, shooting task force will be composed of personnel from the shooter's agency, the DOC. That's what the MOU says. Now, there's not much left to suggest, if this is a dual agency, that the U.S. Marshals Service does much. Next, it's interesting to me that Whitehurst is mentioned.
You've just used your 2 minutes, so if you'd like to sum up.
Okay. My summing up, Your Honor, is that Whitehurst is also a DOC agent and was supervising these two DOC agents. This case is important for many reasons, part of which is due to the nature of our society today. And part of it is due to the fact that officers can't simply say there was a furtive motion and I shot him.
Yeah. Okay.
This car is rocking. He's using the movement of people in an accident to justify a shooting. And I rest.
Okay. Thank both sides for helpful arguments. Nelson and Rapp versus Weber is now submitted for decision.
Judge Fletcher, could we take a few minutes break?
Oh, yes, of course.
Thank you.
Do you want 10 minutes?
Just five minutes is
ample. Let's take a 5-minute break. Okay.